So let's change tack. Well, not really changing much tack, still sticking with the marketplace. And that is where FXTM Lukman is joining us this morning, who's talking to us about. It's good to have you. Thank you. You're sitting close, so you get a handshake.
Thank you.
I couldn't do that off the floor here with Temitope and Mr. Adeyemi earlier. So we're looking at a few economic data, yes, which are very crunching time, as it were. But I'm sure inflation is there, but we don't have the numbers yet. But what's your outlook into what September inflation will look like? Taking our cue from the last MPC, when the central bank chief says, look, we're looking at an uptrend.
Yeah, so as we can see in Nigeria, inflation pressures have been moderating. If you look at the previous inflation figures, it was 11.02%. This has been the lowest level in 3 years. And seeing the stability in the naira exchange, I believe inflation will continue following that trend. And this will be a welcome development for the Nigerian economy, because signs of monitoring inflationary pressures results in investments. It could support consumption. And we know how consumption is roughly 80% of GDP in Nigeria.
Mm. So you see inflation trending lower?
I see it moderating around 11% regions.
Around 11%. Not a major uptick.
A major uptick will come, but I think that will be something we may see in 2020 based on what I saw in the 2020 budget, because we know that VAT is increasing from 5% to 7.5%. At the same time, minimum wage is jumping from 18K to 30K. So these two things may result in inflationary pressures making a return in 2020.
This money is hard to be paid. This budget with minimum wage and all that remains part of the sticky point, including deficit financing and borrowings, both internal and external,
yes,
via treasury bills and all of that, into the revenue box, and how that will help the government balance its recurrent and capital expenditure. So how soon do you think inflation will begin to rear its ugly head in the new year?
It depends, because we know that with the talks with the new minimum wage coming, it hasn't gone through yet, but that's something that we can see in 2020. And with the VAT coming in place in January 2020, it could be something we see in the first quarter of next year.
Interesting, if you drill down on the budget 2020 proposals, where do you see the goodies and the downers?
As you can say, it is a very interesting budget.
Yes.
It's a very, and when we look at things on paper, the 2020 budget does have the ability to elevate the Nigerian economy. But however, if you look at what the International Monetary Fund has already said, they believe that the government's expenditure forecasts are quite optimistic. So when we look at the numbers, so we're talking about a record spending of 10.33 trillion, with the government revenues projected to be at 8.157 trillion, and that leaves us with a deficit of 2.18 trillion, which is going to be financed by external borrowing. But when I'm looking at the government expenditure, there's one key sticking point. So they're looking at oil prices to be around $57 in 2020 and pumping 2.18 million barrels a day. But if you look at oil prices today, oil prices, you know, WTI crude is around $53. But I want us to really focus on oil production. So Nigeria's oil production in August was actually around 1.86 million barrels a day. And according to OPEC, the limit for Nigeria is 1.766 million. And I was looking at reports. So the last time Nigeria was able to pump over 2 million barrels a day, according to the Organization of Energy Exporters, was back in 2013. So that's one key sticking point of the budget. So
while the proposals for next year is 2.3?
Yes.
Yes. It looks very... It looks like something that cross purposes here.
It's quite optimistic, and it leads me to that conclusion that it shows that parts of the budget may be influenced by external drivers in forms of oil. However, I think the most important thing for this is for the budget to be passed in December, because if we saw in 2019, there was repeated delays of the budget, and that impacted its effectiveness. So if the 2020 budget could be passed in December, I think that could be the first step moving forward.
But we've got to deal with the overlaps of 2016, 2017, 2018, 2019. So how do you think, even if we pass the budget by December 1st or end of November, the appropriations, the capital votes of 2019 are still hanging over, and it's been said some of this would have to be rolled over into 2020. So we still have something that we can't really handle here yet. How would that impact on your outlook at FXTM in terms of our GDP?
Yeah, so the recent GDP we saw for Q2 was around 1.94%, and the government is still predicting a GDP of 3% this year.
IMF says 2.3.
Pardon?
IMF says 2.3.
And IMF is saying 2.3. So, yes. You know, what is going to really impact Nigeria's economic outlook is not only domestic factors. We need to come outside of Nigeria and look at external drivers. Now, there's a lot of talk over US-China trade. Now, it's very important. I'm going to repeat what I said to you last time. When two elephants fight, the grass gets hurt. So when we look at total trade flows for Nigeria in 2018 for United States, we're talking about over $9 billion. And trade flows with China in 2018 was $10 billion. So it's very important that the two largest economies do secure some sort of breakthrough deal, because that would positively impact risk sentiment and will feed back to emerging markets, including Nigeria.
But these external vulnerabilities will have to be, if we're going to sell oil, even if we are very optimistic and we deliver on our 2.3 million optimism, we will have to sell it somewhere. So where would the demand come from?
And that's another question. Demand. So now we're speaking about oil prices. Demand is a major, it's one of the major issues, because as you can see with oil markets now, the dynamics have been swinging back and forth. At the start of the year, we're speaking about supply side dynamics, concerns of a negative supply side shocks due to geopolitical tensions pushing oil prices higher. But now, even though we have geopolitical tensions across the board, you know, events in Iran, it seems that oil markets are still heavily focused on demand side concerns. Now, these demand side concerns come in a form of uncertainty of the global economy. The IMF have downgraded their growth forecast for this year to 3.2%. The Organization of Economic Development has seen 2.9%. Even the World Bank is expressing concerns over the global economy. So my conclusion to this, as long as there's concerns over trade developments, this is going to weigh heavily on oil markets.
And so the political leaders, as it were, and policymakers are beginning to hand over things technically to central banks around the world. So talk about the ECB, the BOJ, the PBOC, and the Fed.
Yes.
So everybody's going to the marketplace. That's where it looks like. Look, we just have to do something. Does it look like the central banks are the ones who will be able to provide a measure of safety net or try to dodge the bullet, as it were, for the global economy to avoid recession?
So, major central banks across the world, as you say, have turned on the monetary policy life support to prevent the global economy from flatlining. You know, over 40 central banks, including the European Central Bank and the Federal Reserve, have cut interest rates in a form to support the global economy. In fact, earlier, I was believing that the Central Bank of Nigeria will join the global easing train. But then when we look at Nigeria's economy, I think the CBN's decision is based on two things. Firstly, if the CBN cuts interest rates, this could force inflationary pressures to rebound. And this is not something that the CBN
wants. And we don't have a strong buffers for that.
But alternatively, though, the pressure of central banks across the world taking a move should encourage other emerging markets to to cut interest rates. But to answer your question, even though global easing across the world may provide a band-aid to the global economy, I think the life-saving medicine should be a breakthrough deal between the United States and China. And when I mean a breakthrough deal, I mean to remove all tariffs that have been implemented since the start of the trade war.
So both the Fed and the PBOC are looking more into the financial market asset place. So you talk about bond buying, talk about treasury bills buying, trying to go into the money market, trying to get the financial market stable and confidence. Because once you spook investors' confidence in financial assets, then the rest is as anyone's guess.
Exactly, and that's what they're preventing, you know, this return of risk aversion. For example, it was very interesting. Over the weekend, there was this wave of optimism when we heard United States and China secured phase one of the trade deal, only for us to read reports yesterday that China is not really ready and they want to go back to the negotiating table before they
sign. They want hard numbers.
They want hard numbers.
Yes, and that's what the Chinese want. If they don't have hard numbers, they don't believe that any deal has been secured. So that takes us back to the financial market. So what do we do in terms of who gets hit first? A currency. So the Chinese are doing all that they could to make sure there is liquidity.
Yes.
The Hong Kong Central Bank this morning, according to CNBC, is reporting how to reduce the reserves of the banks in Hong Kong to let more liquidity out into the system. Because, hold on a second, this is as funny as it gets. But again, it looks like everybody's just scrambling everywhere. What can I do? So currency is going to be a major issue here for everyone, whether frontier, emerging, developed markets.
Yes. So in times like this, when risk aversion is a major theme, naturally riskier assets and emerging market currencies are put down, and investors tend to rush to, as you said, bonds, the safe haven in Japanese yen, and of course, that thing that sparkles that everybody loves, gold. So gold is a very attractive place in times of uncertainty. And going back to what we're saying, global concerns over the global economic landscape, geopolitical risks, and lower interest rates across the globe make gold, which is a zero-yielding asset, a very, very attractive destination for safety.
Oh, we forgot Brexit.
I was hoping you would ask me
about Brexit.
I wanted to ask about Brexit.
Brexit is here, and it looks like if it unpacks with no deal and all of that, it's going to reverberate around the world. No one should be in doubt of that.
Yes. So, like with the Brexit, it reminds me of a broken record. It just keeps going on and on and on. Today we had reports of them being some sort of a deal in place, but even if that does become reality, whatever is put on the table needs to go through to the EU summit on the 17th and the 18th, and it needs to be passed through Parliament on October the 19th. So we have two barriers. So I think it's too early to get excited, but if a no-deal Brexit becomes reality, it's not only the United Kingdom that will be hit. It could even spread all the way to Africa, including Nigeria. So the total trade flows with the UK and Nigeria back in 2018 was around 5 billion. And the EU acts as a middleman between the UK and Nigeria when it comes to trade. So if the United Kingdom is ripped out of the European Union, this may cause trade disruptions. At the same time, there's a lot of investments that come from the United Kingdom to Nigeria.
Yeah, whether to DFID or OFID office or whatever you call it. Quite a lot of agencies there, OPIC and the rest of them. So we're going to need to be ready somehow.
So if the UK does experience a recession due to the negative impacts of a no-deal Brexit, naturally the impacts will reverberate back to Nigeria. That's why, going back to what I was saying, even though we're speaking about Nigeria, it's a mixture of domestic and external factors that will influence how the economy ends in 2019.
Quite a lot of head-scratching. Now we have less than 90 days to the end of the year. Yeah, 2020, something to think about. Okay, let's leave it here for now. Thank you so much, Lukman Otunuga.
Thank you very much.
From a senior research analyst at FXTM. Again, keep an eye on Brexit and whatever. Maybe we'll talk on 31st or maybe after that.
I'll give you a call and keep you updated.
We need to talk on October 31st. Just get ready. Yes. Thank you, everyone. Let's come back to you after the break. 2 minutes, you're watching Business Morning.